About Dogs on BCTV is supported by the Berks County Kennel Club and by the Berks County Dog Training Club.
Good evening and welcome to the Berks County Kennel Club's program, All About Dogs. Hi, I'm Pat Mock, your host, and this evening we have two interesting breeds for you. They are both sighthounds, so they see the prey as opposed to scenthounds who smell the prey on the ground. So we've got two different hunting dogs that both see to chase down what they, you know, the deer or whatever they're chasing down. So our first guest that we're going to speak to this evening is John Minoski, and he has a new breed, one that we haven't had on the program before. It's an Ibizan hound, and that's the hairless, well, short hairs, not hairless, but short-haired one, who now promptly laid down. She's been standing all this time, he's been standing all this time, and now he's tired out. Suppose you tell us what an Ibizan is. It's obviously looks greyhoundy.
An Ibizan is very much like a greyhound, just a little more substance to it. Maybe not quite as fast, but is a runner.
Okay. Where did they come from?
They were 3400 BC.
Oh,
and,
wow. Okay.
Egyptian hieroglyphics. Okay. And about 800 BC, they were brought in by the Spanish and ended up on the Isle of Ibiza.
Oh, how about that? That's why they look like those at the Pharaoh dogs, right at the pyramids. Yes, you do. They have big ears, don't they?
Yes,
very big ears. Why was this dog bred as a hunting dog?
They were rabbit hunters.
Really, rabbit
yes.
hunters? Huh? Did they just chase them down and kill them, or
they will
or
run them down
and kill
and
them?
Grab them.
Okay. Well. One way to get dinner, I guess. How popular is this?
It's not a popular breed.
No. And they seem very calm.
They're great dogs.
Really? Because I know a lot of people, they don't want a greyhound because they say it's so energetic, it runs, and it's like, no, a greyhound doesn't. It runs out in the backyard for 5 minutes and then it comes in and sleeps for 6 hours. Is this about the same way? A lot of exercise? And it's done, you know, flashing.
No, they're busy dogs.
Are they busy dogs?
They're busy dogs. They need lots of exercise.
Okay. Obviously, a fenced yard is a must.
At least a 4 foot fenced yard.
Yeah.
These dogs can clear 6 foot.
Really? Well, with the legs on, you know, I don't know if you can get the legs. He's turning his butt, so we can't really see. They do. There you go. The legs on the dog. They're really long. He's a long leggy guy. So I can imagine that definitely he would be able to easily clear a 6 foot fence. Do they have any health problems? Since it's such an unusual, not popular breed.
It's an ancient breed. They don't have a whole lot of problems. They can have issues with being allergic to medicines and vaccinations.
Okay.
And they can develop eye problems.
Because of
their light eyes.
Oh, okay. Would sun have anything to do with that, or
no? It's basically it's in a line.
Okay.
It's a genetic thing.
Okay, but it's not PRA. It's not progressive retinal atrophy.
No.
Okay. I just wondered if it was PRA because they, you know, when you talk about the older breeds, like with the greyhounds, they're really really healthy. The greyhounds are unbelievably healthy, but if you think way back, they didn't keep the unhealthy ones. If it didn't hunt, it was just killed.
Well, these dogs still run loose on the island of Ibiza, and
really?
It's survival of the fittest.
Oh, my God. Wow, I didn't know that. So why did you decide to get this breed?
I actually saw one at a dog show, and I thought she was absolutely stunning, so I decided to try one.
Okay. This is one the breed that took Best in Show a couple of years at Westminster, right?
No, she won the group.
Just the group, okay.
Yeah.
Playmate.
Yeah, funny.
Playmate. Okay, yeah. Yeah, she was very stunning.
Yeah.
And she really showed well. She should have won. I don't know what won that year. I can't remember from year to year. But so the temperament on these guys is pretty sweet.
They can be standoffish.
Oh, okay.
To strangers, he's kind of the exception.
Okay.
They can be a little standoffish. Once they get to know you, they're your buddy. They can be very independent, though.
Well, that's understandable. I mean, they don't really need humans to survive.
No.
You know, and a lot of the breeds that we say are independent, they don't need us to survive. They can do it very well on their own. They've been doing it for hundreds of years. Thank you very much. And, you know, you're just sort of the giver of the food. Are they easy to train?
Yeah.
Or do they have that independent streak and say,
They have an independent streak. They're fairly easy to train.
Okay. I would assume that very food motivated.
Yes.
Okay. That's the easiest way to train with food, that's for sure. So what, if you had to change something about this breed, what would you change?
I don't really know that I'd change anything about it.
Really? They don't shed?
They shed, but...
I see some hairs flying around here, but I think it's from the borzoi.
They're just a great dog.
Do they come in other colors?
They must be red and white. They can be any combination of red and white. They can be all white.
Okay.
But those are the only two acceptable colors.
Huh. I don't think I've ever seen an all white one. They probably don't do as well.
Yes, they...
Really?
They exist.
But not very much in the breed ring. They're just not...
There's a couple.
Really?
Yeah.
Huh. I don't think I've ever seen an all-white one. I've always seen the red, and usually with the patched the eyes, you know, around the eyes. And they don't come in long hair. They're always short-haired.
No, there is a wire-haired Ibethan.
Really? And it looks like...
It looks like them with long wired hair.
Long hair like the borzoi, or not?
Not quite that long. It can just be... It can be very little, or it can be longer.
Huh. Interesting. Are they acceptable as well, or?
They are acceptable, but to be honest, they're two totally different dogs.
Really?
Temperament-wise, they're two different dogs.
Huh. Now, isn't that interesting?
They are a lot more, how would you put, they're a lot softer, they're a lot more... You know, aloof and
okay. Now that's really interesting because I've never seen a wire coat either. Ah, very, very interesting. That's like the Weimaraners. Somebody told me that's in the German line with the Weimaraners. They have long coated Weimaraners. I don't know. They're not acceptable in the breed ring, but the Ibizans they are, huh?
Yes.
Wow, that's great. How much exercise do these guys really require? Could it be kept in an apartment?
If you give it enough exercise, it can be kept in an apartment.
Okay, so it's not a barker.
They can be barkers.
Oh, they can be barkers. Well, then.
If you keep them, exercise will
help.
What
I'm thinking of is maybe an elderly couple. Like in a retirement community. Would this be a good
no.
dog?
No.
Okay. What about children? Are they okay with kids?
They're great with kids.
Okay. All righty. What else do I want to ask you about them? Oh, the exercise. How much do they require? Would you say a walk around the block is okay for them? Or would you have to go a couple of miles?
A walk around the block, you know, a couple trips around the block, or just... If you have a big enough yard, you know, they can be self-entertaining.
Okay.
He loves to go for on the bike. He likes to get hooked up to the bike and go on the bike.
Oh, my goodness. Well, somebody tired him out this evening already. He's sleeping. Well, don't wake him up, the poor guy. Now, he also is a group winner, isn't he? He's a breed winner.
He's won several groups, too.
Okay.
He was the 2010 breed winner at Westminster.
Very good. Congratulations. That's great. If I wanted this breed of dog, what are we talking about as far as price?
That can depend. Probably for a pet, you're looking around 1,000.
Okay. All right. I thought it
can go up
right,
from there.
Right. Because they aren't as popular that they would be pricier, but they're not really, because that's basically,
no,
you know, 1,000 to 1,500 is basically in this area what you would pay for a purebred dog. Their tails are just so so interesting. It's this little skinny. Hey, sir. What's
Sergio.
His name?
Sergio.
Sergio, get up. Let's see your skinny tail. I just think their tails are so. Can you get him to turn around so we can actually see his face? He's got the prettiest face. Nah, he's still not gonna.
No, wait.
There you go. That's better. And he's still gonna look at you. Still look at Daddy. Nope. When I said they were food motivated, I really meant it. No, he's just going to check out if there's something behind him. Oh, he's going to scrap, maybe. There you go. Now that's a beautiful pose, except we're going to lay down right away. Oh, well. Okay. Well, at least you got some idea of what they look like. I think we have to take a break now. So we're going to take a station break, and then we'll be right back and talk about the Borzoi.
You're watching All About Dogs on bctv.org. Be informed, be involved, be a member. For membership information, go to www.bctv.org/support/membership. For more information and other stories about animals and pets, go to www.bctv.org. All About Dogs is underwritten by the Berks County Kennel Club and by Berks Dog Training Club. For more information on how you and your business can become program underwriters, go to www.bctv.org.
And we're back. Now we're going to talk about the long-haired ones on this side. We've got three of them here. These are the Borzois. And their owner is Cindy
Lastukas.
Uh-huh. Okay. It's really a long name. Jeez, couldn't even get it on the screen, I don't think. Tell me a little bit about the Borzoi. Like, these were the Irish wolfhounds, right?
No, these were Russian wolfhounds.
Russian
wolfhounds.
I don't know why I said Irish. Right. The Irish are chunkier.
Yeah.
The Russian wolfhounds.
Yeah, these were
right.
Russian wolfhounds, and the word Borzoi actually in Russian just means fast.
Oh.
And,
how about that?
Yeah. And. That was changed in the 1920s. They changed it from Russian wolfhound to the word Borzoi. Yes.
And
yes.
People are still calling them Russian wolfhounds.
Yes.
Isn't
yes.
that interesting?
Yep.
Why the name would never.
It was on the heels of the Bolshevik Revolution in 1917.
Okay. Yeah.
And so many of these dogs were slaughtered by the militants in Russia at that time because they were, so associated with. You know, the aristocracy
royalty.
And royalty.
Mm-hmm.
And, up until the revolution, it was only the aristocracy that could own them.
Mm-hmm.
And they were never sold. They were given as gifts.
Mm-hmm.
And
Wow.
It was a couple of Americans went over there and rescued quite a few from the different kennels and brought them to America. And that's how our Wolfhound Club here got started.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Very interesting. So it was back in the 1920s, 30s, probably.
The 20s, right. Yeah.
Because this, too, is an old breed?
Not really. The Borzoi, the modern Borzoi that we see today, was only developed in the mid-1800s. And up until that point, different regions of Russia had their own version of a Borzoi. And so.
Like a lot of the breeds, you know, you went
from
this region to that region, and the dogs look totally different, depending on what they were breeding with
exactly.
in that general area.
Right.
But these guys used to hunt not only wolf, but deer. They were...
No. They were used on hare and wolf.
Oh, is that all?
They were never used on deer.
Huh.
And the wolves, they would always hunt three of them at a time. They would release a slip of three. And they would hold the wolf until the hunter came and dispatched the wolf, or they retrieved the wolf for training of puppies.
Okay.
So, but it was, it was purely a sport.
Aw.
So.
That's a shame.
Yeah.
That's a shame. But, we have strange sports now, too. And now we beat each other instead of, you know,
oh, yeah,
the dogs.
That's true.
Yeah, so that's okay. I mean, beat each other senseless. Mm-hmm. But they obviously come in different colors.
Oh, yes, yes. And that's why I brought the three that okay. I did, because so many people, you know, are under the impression they only come in white.
Sure.
And Tsar Nicholas kept a kennel of white dogs. And the different kennels in Russia usually had a color theme. And so because the Romanov kennel, you know, yeah. was, of course, the most renowned, and his dogs were white, so many people, you know, as I said, are under the impression that they only come in white. And then, I don't know if you remember, years ago, there was a Smirnoff vodka ad campaign with
right,
the all-white Borzoi.
Yes.
But, yeah, they come in a variety of colors. I mean, and this is, you know, just...
Well,
three
I'm partial
of the many.
To, you know, the black and white.
Uh-huh, okay.
Oh, the old girl, I guess, is...
Oh, yes.
Yeah, right.
Mm-hmm. She's a brindle. She's a red brindle with a black sable mantle. And then, of course, the...
You all get that? A black brindle with a red sable.
On top.
We don't know exactly what that means.
It's like low lights.
Jesus. The highlights is the brindle and the sable is the...
There you go. There you go. Yep.
Now, when you say sable, are you talking about this red color?
No.
The sable is...
It's just a coat that comes in, a color of coat that comes in and obscures the brindle. And the older they get, the less you can make out the actual brindle pattern on them.
Oh, okay.
So
then what color is sable? Is it black?
Well, it has black tips.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Because sable in so many different breeds is mm-hmm. so many different colors.
Right, right.
You know, some sable, like a Sheltie, a sable is her color, red.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And then you have the sable in other dogs, other breeds, and it's black. And it's, well, what color is sable?
Yeah. It's usually black tips on some base color
mm-hmm.
coat.
Mm-hmm.
So...
Well, I can't see her because the white
yeah.
one's in the way.
Yeah.
And he's the youngster?
He's the youngster. Yeah,
okay.
He's two.
Right.
So.
But they seem, too, very gentle.
Oh, they are. They are. I love this breed. I acquired my first one through a rescue in 1974.
Oh, my.
And I was hooked
uh-huh.
after that, you know,
uh-huh.
just because they don't have a doggy odor.
Right.
You know, because they don't carry a lot of body fat.
Mm-hmm.
And, so, you know, you don't have that. And also because of the fact they don't excrete a lot of oil through their skin, their coat is almost self-cleaning, you know, because
wow.
dirt doesn't stick to it.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
And that's nice. And they're quiet.
They do have the double coat, though, correct?
Well, no, only in the winter. They develop a very short, thick, coarse undercoat
fluffy,
for
right.
winter.
Mm-hmm.
Hmm. Yeah.
Because obviously, if they're coming from Russia, we have some very cold parts of Russia
mm-hmm.
that they would need if they're out hunting.
Yes.
They would need that kind of.
Yep, and they carry that in the winter, through the winter.
Hmm.
And in north, you know, the further north you go in this country, you know, the
heavier the
longer,
coat is.
Right,
sure, the
right.
The longer you hold that undercoat.
Mm-hmm.
Do they always have the, well, I guess with the white ones, they don't. No, I think they even prefer the color on the face of the white ones, don't they? Or are they pure white?
There are pure white dogs, yes. Yeah.
Huh.
So,
I like the color. I'm sorry.
Mm-hmm.
I like
yeah.
the color.
Yeah.
Now, how popular are these guys?
You know, it's so difficult to say. I would say not very popular at all. But
do you think it's because of the grooming or because of the size?
I think the size is part of it, and I think the fact that they are an independent breed.
Okay.
You know, like all the sighthounds were bred to hunt independently of man.
Mm-hmm.
So they have no compulsion against
doing
leaving.
Their own thing.
Right, right.
So we have two dogs that do their own things here.
Yep.
What about health problems on these guys?
The biggest health problem is bloat and torsion.
Oh,
and that
really?
Happens in a lot of the deep-chested breeds.
Yeah.
And they're not quite sure. I mean,
yeah.
they're not really sure what causes it. They're not sure if there's a genetic link for it, you know, if it's just purely, you know, physiology, you know,
yeah.
because of the deep chest
right,
and
right.
how well sprung the rib cage is, or
wow.
Whether you feed them twice daily or you feed them standing up or laying down. So.
Well, I just read something not that long ago that the study that they did, I think it was at the University of Michigan, that department said that you shouldn't feed them standing up because that was the worst thing you could do for them since they're not using the muscles in the throat to get it. Who knows?
Right, because you have other studies that say you should.
Yes, you feed them up.
Right, right.
Yeah, nobody knows anything. It's just a problem with the dogs. Is that the only problem they have?
I would think that they do not
have any hip problems at all.
No, they don't. That's, practically unheard of.
Right.
That they would have any genetic predisposition towards, any of
the And they don't have
dysplasias.
Any eye problems either.
No, they don't. They don't. PRA is not a problem in this breed.
Yeah.
So.
Isn't that interesting how it affects some breeds and not others?
Yeah, and I'm sure, being a sighthound, I'm sure at one point they started selecting,
for good eyesight. Sure.
And so that may be something that was weeded out early in the in the development of the breed.
Yeah, that's very possible because, mm-hmm. If they didn't bring home supper, they, the Ibizans were, they never came home.
Yeah.
They just never came home.
Yep.
As far as exercise, do they require a lot?
Well, they're, as young puppies, it's good to have a large enclosed area, where they can play with one another. And I think they develop best that way.
Okay.
If they have litter mates to run and play with. But beyond that, no, they don't require a lot of exercise. I mean, you need to get them out, walk them. Mm-hmm. Of course, if you're doing, any of the coursing events or oval racing, you need to keep them conditioned, with regular exercise.
Sure. I mean, it's like anything else, you wouldn't, if you haven't run in, 16 years, you certainly aren't going to go out there and run a 5-mile race.
Mm-hmm.
Would they be good for an apartment dog?
Great. Yes.
Kids?
They're good with children if they're raised with children.
Okay.
Because children tend to move quickly, sometimes
okay.
that can...
Being a sighthound,
that triggers that instinct.
That's exactly right. It's like the border collies. They, too, are, the kids move fast and the dogs are right around whipping them back into,
Right.
The kids aren't going to play at different sides of the yard. And
right.
I would assume that... Yeah. And people, I think, a lot of times don't even consider that. They don't even think about that when they're getting a dog.
No,
which they don't. Which is sort of silly.
Mm-hmm.
Do you need to do a lot of grooming on these guys since they do have a coat? Would you say, do you brush them? Maybe once a week?
Well, it's a good, brushing them and grooming them is a great way to bond with them,
right.
And show them affection. But I think if you were, to just brush through their coat maybe 2 or 3 times a week, that's sufficient.
Okay. Well, probably, it doesn't look like a coat that would mat easily.
No, the only part of their body coat that you need to, really pay attention to, are the feathering.
The pants and the back and the probably around the ears
right.
as well.
Yes.
Right.
Yep.
What would you, hi, hon.
Hi.
What would you change about this breed? And why did you select this breed?
Well, I just thought they were absolutely gorgeous.
They're very elegant.
Beautiful. And I like them because, as I said, they don't have a doggy odor. Mm-hmm. They're not a busy dog.
Okay.
They're not a needy dog. I enjoy that about them.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
They're quiet. They rarely bark. And they're just very easy to live with.
Yeah. Most people who have sighthounds feel that they're an easy breed to live with.
Yeah, yeah.
Because they just sort of do their thing and then take a nap.
Yeah.
It's like, okay, well, we'll run around the yard and, for 15, 20 minutes, and then, okay, we'll take a nap now for,
right.
give me a sofa.
Right,
well,
right.
You always see them lying in front of the fireplace.
Uh-huh.
That kind of thing. They're
that
lying
happens.
They're lying in front of the fireplace. And if that's your lifestyle, that's great.
Mm-hmm.
If that's what you want your dog to do, I don't ever get a chance to sit in front of my fireplace.
Mm-hmm.
I'm too gosh darn busy.
Yeah.
So this, for me, even though it's a gorgeous breed, would not be my breed of choice because it doesn't do anything I like to do. Yeah.
Well, the flip side of that, though, is the fact that you can go out to the oval races or you can go out to the field trials. and you can just see them turn it on, mm-hmm. you know, and that's another enjoyable aspect of having this breed is right. to watch them run.
Yes.
You know,
and
I mean,
gorgeous.
It's just beautiful. And
yes.
to watch them work, you know, the lure
uh-huh.
at a field trial and to watch them work together because they, at the field trials, they do run three at a time.
Oh, okay.
And as they would have traditionally hunted them.
Okay.
And the lure courses are laid out on a course that measures between 600 and 1,000 yards. And all the turns are designed to simulate the way a rabbit would actually run and turn, you know, if it were trying to evade
mm-hmm.
hounds
right.
coming after
so
it.
What is, you said oval track. Is that like the racetrack that they're
yes,
doing?
Yes, okay. but it's a hobby sport.
Okay.
It's not...
Right,
it has
right.
nothing to do with the greyhound
well,
racing.
That is just fairly new, isn't it?
Actually, they've been doing it with whippets for quite a while.
Okay.
But with the larger sighthounds, it pretty much got started in the mid '80s.
Okay.
And
so, what do you have? Like
a
six
starting
hounds, eight
four,
hounds?
And
four,
they come
okay.
out of a starting box.
Okay.
And
so it is basically just like the greyhound
yes,
racing.
Yes.
Except
yes.
that they're you know.
Yeah, and there's a mechanical rabbit, uh-huh. which is actually just a white plastic trash bag on the end of a a take-up reel.
Yes. My dog and I did the lure coursing. You know, I don't have a hound, but
mm-hmm.
and she thought that was great fun.
Oh yeah,
she just thought it was such great fun to chase this white plastic bag.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, okay, then what do you do when you catch it? Well,
yeah, yeah.
But that's great, and we tire them all out now. Isn't that awful?
Yeah.
So I guess that's going to be our program for this evening because all the dogs are asleep. This one isn't.
No,
so,
the youngster.
for this evening, that's our program. I thank both of our guests for being here and also the hairy guests as well. Next month, we're going to have Australian cattle dogs and border collies, two breeds that we've not seen on the program before. So stay tuned next month. For this evening, good night.
All About Dogs on BCTV is supported by